Good morning. I am very glad to be here at the Valparaiso First Presbyterian Church. And I want to specifically thank Pastor Mark and Rhonda Kaufman for inviting me on behalf of all of you. I always give thanks to God for the opportunity to proclaim the Word of God. An awesome privilege and a great responsibility. Since you don't know me very well, I want to begin by telling you a story about myself and my husband, Bill. Several years ago, we found ourselves on a dance floor in the high school, local high school at Mount Clemens, Michigan. We thought it would be fun to learn how to ballroom dance, to dance the waltz, and the cha-cha-cha, and the tango, and the zumba. It was fun, but it was also really good exercise for our health. It relieved some stress that we had when we were co-pastors at the Mount Clemens First Presbyterian Church in Michigan. It gave us some exercise for our bodies and stimulated our minds, always trying to remember the different kinds of dance configurations. Now, dancing was all new to Bill, but I had been a dancer in my earlier years, so I was very anxious to get started. Well, in the midst of our many lessons, the teacher kept saying to me, "Roxie, you can't lead. That's Bill's job." And Bill would echo his comments, "Roxie, stop leading. I got this. I think you have control issues." Which I do. In ballroom dancing, just watch Dancing with the Stars, the male leads and the woman has to follow. Hate to say it, women, but that's just the way it is in ballroom dancing. Now, perhaps it's our resistance to control that there is a lot of line dancing going on now. And in rock and roll movement, you don't really need to have a partner because you don't really hold hands. Now, it seems to me that ballroom dancing is like navigating life with God as our dance partner. But we, like me, have a tendency to want to lead. We will resist God's leadership. We will be self-sufficient, not relying upon God. And we want to make our own decisions about the direction of our lives. But as Christians, that is not the way it works. Our focus is to see and to feel God as our partner, holding our hand and firmly moving us through gentle pressure on our backside. God in Jesus Christ leads. Leads us in our personal and our family life, in this body of Christ, the church, and believe it or not, whether we like it or not, God is the one who must lead this country and must lead the world. God is constantly saying to us in Scripture, "Follow my lead." It says in Proverbs 3, 5 and 6, which we read from this morning, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge God, and he will direct your paths." In ballroom dancing, your right and your left foot have to match the movement of the right and left foot of the partner. The same is true when following God's lead. Now, there are many attributes of God which we are called to match. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control, all the fruits of the Spirit. Now, right now, you are in a season of stewardship, and you will make your decision this coming week as you will give of your resources, of your money, to the ministry of Jesus Christ in this place and at this time. So I want to talk today about the attribute of generosity and gratitude. Gratitude and generosity are two sides of the same body, the left foot and the right foot, leading us in our dance with God. You see, gratitude moves us to generosity, which is one of the fruits of the Spirit. Generosity is gratitude in action. Gratitude is defined as being thankful, being ready to show appreciation for something or for someone. Several months ago, I was with a group of Christian friends, and one of the pastors in the group led us in a game called Be Thankful. We had to write down as fast as we could at least 10 or more things that we were thankful for. But if someone else wrote down the same thing, we had to cross it off, and the winner was the one who had the longest list at the end of the time. So thinking that I'm a very competitive person and a rather clever person, I didn't write down all the things that most Christian people would write down, like God and Jesus, the church, my family, my friends. No. I decided that I would write down all those little things that we take for granted, like toilet paper and drinking water, my pillow, gas for my car, my shoes, and broccoli, of course. I didn't win, but the game reminded me how much we have that we take for granted and don't give thanks to God for. In the light of the events of the past weeks, Hurricane Harvey and Irma and Jose, the earthquake in Mexico, the refugee crisis because of terrorism and violence, many of those people have lost everything. But for us, we still have all our stuff. Give thanks. For it is in gratitude that moves us to generosity. Now, generosity is defined as the quality of being kind, understanding, and not selfish. The quality of being generous is especially the willingness to give money or other valuable things like time and energy to benefit the needs of others. Generosity is being open-handed rather than closed-fist. Most of you don't know that in retirement, I am a volunteer foster grandmother in a kindergarten class 3 days a week in Port Huron, Michigan. Now, this is a national program that's been around for about 50 years that is operated by the Council on Aging. Now, it could be said that everything we know about gratitude and generosity, we learned in kindergarten. Two things that all kindergartners should know before they graduate from kindergarten is how to say thank you and how to share. But neither one of these lessons comes easily. They are learned behavior. Let me give you an example. Five children sit around each of the tables in my classroom, and each table is given two baskets of new crayons. They are delighted to have the new crayons. But before the baskets are put down on their table, I say to them, "And what do you say?" And you hope that they all chime in to say, "Thank you." Doesn't always happen. Gratitude is a learned behavior. But the next step, in tandem with the thank you, comes the statement from me, Now you have to share the crayons with each other. You can't grab the basket. You can't take all the crayons for yourself. No, there are four other people sitting around this table with whom you must share the crayons. And they look up at me with their big, wide-eyed questioning and thinking, really? You just gave us those crayons. And of course, we are thankful. At least we think we're thankful, not entitled to them. But now you're asking us to share? Really? Yeah. Really. You must share them with the people sitting at your table. If we're going to follow God's lead in this dance of life, first we must recognize that everything we have is God's, not ours. God has graciously and generously given us everything for our enjoyment and for sharing with others. It says in Psalm 24:1, "The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it." In 1 Timothy 6, verse 17 and 18, from which we read this morning, the Apostle Paul speaks to his younger colleague, Timothy, and to us. He says, "Tell those who are rich in the world, you and I are very rich in this world. Tell them not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which will soon be gone. But their trust should be in the living God, who richly gives us all we need, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment." So that leads me to my next point. Our trust in God moves us to be generous. In 2009, I received my Doctor of Ministry degree from the Ecumenical Theological Seminary in Detroit. And my dissertation was on stewardship. The basic question of my dissertation was, why do people give financially to the church, give financially to God through the church for the benefit of others? And I interviewed a lot of people who gave very little to God through the church, and a lot of people who gave substantial amounts to God through the church. Being poor or rich or any place in between didn't matter when it came to the proportion or the percentage of what they gave from their income to the church. What mattered was who owned what they had. Did it belong to them or to God? And did they trust God's wisdom and provision, or did they just trust their own? Those that gave very little percentage of their income to God through the church saw their resources and their money as their own. Their attitude was, I earned it. I get to spend it. And they gave less to God than they were capable of giving. And really, they had a lack of trust in God to provide for their needs. They were very afraid of that. Those who gave more substantial percentage of their income to God through the church knew deep in their hearts that everything belongs to God. Their resources, their time, their talent, their treasure are only theirs to manage for God's glory and for God's purpose. They trusted God's word in 2 Corinthians 9:8, where it says, God is able to give you more than you need, so that you will always have all you need for yourselves and more than enough for every good cause. But let me remind you, those who gave a substantial percentage of their income to God, poor or rich or in between, didn't come by it naturally. It was, again, a learned behavior. They were intentional about their money management and their generosity. It was not always easy for them. They shared with me that they had to make choices and sacrifices so that they could give what they thought God was leading them to give. They trusted God's judgment and leadership in their lives more than they trusted their own understanding. Remember what it says in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways, acknowledge God, and He will make straight your paths. But then it goes on in Proverbs to say, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear or respect for God, and turn away from evil. It will be healing for your flesh and a refreshment for your body. In terms of generosity, when you're generous, it is healing for your flesh and a refreshment for your body. Generosity moves you to have better health. Yes, there are health benefits to being generous. Recently, the annual Stress in America study published by the American Psychological Association states, we know that money is the number one source of stress in our lives. It is the number one cause of divorce. We also know that stress is the leading cause of negative health outcomes like heart disease and diabetes and insomnia. But the report, instead of recommending to us that to do something about how we handle our money, like being more generous, what they recommend is physical activity, meditation, or take a pill. Now, I'm not knocking any of those solutions because I'm an advocate of healthy habits. But I think a huge solution is left out of the study. Generosity with our time and our talents and our treasure, our money, could solve a lot of our stress problems. There are benefits for us, as it says in Proverbs and in 1 Timothy, that when generosity gets lived out in our lives, the benefit is not only for us, but for others that are around us. Generosity has everything to do with our commitment to share the good news of God's love freely given to us in Jesus Christ, that we might share that with others, loving our neighbors as ourselves. The Apostle Paul goes on in 1 Timothy 6, tell the rich to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and should give generously to those in need, always being ready to share with others whatever God has given them. Just as ballroom dancing helped Bill and me to get some exercise and improve our health, dancing with God, following His moves of gratitude and generosity, leads to better health, not only for us, but for others. It is healing and refreshing for one's body, mind, and soul. And lastly, when we follow God's lead in the dance of life, we will receive God's blessings in abundance. And this is particularly true when we tithe, give 10% of our income to God, or if we are looking at the goal of tithing of 10%, and perhaps we're giving right now 3%, to raise it to 4% or 5%, heading towards that goal of tithing. In both Proverbs 3 and in Malachi 3, God makes promises to us. God says in Proverbs, honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will be bursting with wine. In Malachi, it says, bring the full tithe, 10%, into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house, and that's the Lord's house, the test, says the Lord of hosts. See if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you an overflowing blessing. Now I can only witness to my own story about tithing. It was close to 45 years ago that Bill and I were co-pastors in a small church in Brockton, Massachusetts. In 1973, our salary was $12,000. And we were sleeping on the floor without a mattress because we couldn't afford it. We lived in a tenement house in the inner city of Brockton, Massachusetts. And it was in that parish that an older couple, the bishops, interesting name, the bishops challenged us to tithe, give 10% of our small income to God through the church. The idea was overwhelming for us. But as we looked at the bishops, a retired couple, they had been blue-collar workers all their lives, living on a fixed income, but who were content and blessed. We said, you know, if the bishops can tithe, then we can tithe and watch what God does. And God has abundantly blessed my husband and I, not with a lot of things, but with contentment and joy and peace. And what else could I ask? So I challenge each one of you, as you consider your pledge for this year, your commitment, giving to God through this church, consider the tithe, or at least consider working toward the tithe, 10% of your income. Believe me, try it. You'll like it. So I leave you with this last story. A Sunday school teacher decided to have her second grade class memorize the familiar 23rd Psalm, and she had given the children a month to learn that psalm. And one little boy was so excited about the task, but try as he may, he just couldn't memorize Psalm 23. Although he practiced and he practiced, he could hardly get past the first line. But the day came when the children stood before the congregation to recite the 23rd Psalm. And the little boy was nervous, but when his turn came, he stepped up to the microphone and proudly said, "The Lord is my shepherd." And that's all I need to know. And that's all we need to know. Jesus will shepherd our decisions. God will lead us in the dance when we trust God with our lives and with our resources. It says in Luke 6:38, "Give, and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure that you receive back." May you, as a congregation, live through generosity and gratitude. What you say about yourselves on your website. You say, "We are a church of purpose and prayer, presence and power and people. It is not about us, but it's about God working through us." Blessings on your ministry here in Valparaiso. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.